Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord and the Savior Christ Jesus. Full measure of his mercy, compassion, and love that surrounds you each and every day in his peace, in his name. Amen.
Amen.
And we pray. O Almighty and most merciful God, you bring us through that time and every day with the Lord Jesus Christ to enter with him into that glory. Grant us grace at all times to acknowledge and accept your holy, gracious will to remain in that one true faith and to find peace and joy in that resurrection of the dead, in the glory of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And he will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will never slumber. Indeed, he watches over you. He will never slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. And the sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm, and he'll watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as was in the beginning, is now, and forever. Amen.
Amen.
We turn to our hymnal that you have. We're going to have to get you some up front. We'll wait a minute. Hymn number 770, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Thank you.
The word of the Lord. From Job chapter 19, verses 23 through 27. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed in with an iron tool on lead, engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the great resurrection chapter, 51 through 57. I tell you a mystery, we will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable body must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. The question, death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O death, where is your victory? Thanks be to God who gives us victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Revelation chapter 7, 9 through 17. After this I looked, and therefore before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, every tribe, every people, every language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. And they were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders asked me, these in white robes, who are they and where do they come from? I said, sir, you know. And he said, they are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They've washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat upon them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The Gospel of our Lord. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will not drive away. For I have come down from heaven and to do my will, my Father, of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose none that he has given me, but raise him up at the last day. For my Father's will, that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life. And I will raise him up at that last day. John chapter 14, 1 through 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, and if it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be also where I am. You know the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, how do we know where you're going? How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and life. The one who comes to the Father comes through me. The Gospel of our Lord. Our response now is Amazing Grace. You have a copy of the photocopy that you received. Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord and our Savior Christ Jesus be with you now and always. Amen. Today we celebrate and grieve at the same time. It's not easy to say goodbye to a loved one, but we know that he is in his eternal rest and that he is in the Father's glory and waiting for that day of the resurrection. All the years and all the times and all the joys and all the moves to hear for a lot of years. It's been almost 50 years, wasn't it?
49 years.
Yeah. A lot of times together and a lot of memories to hold on to. Remember the tents, camping, fishing, of course, and busy, and a lot of work, and a lot of time, and a lot of time and energy and dedication to family, and watching over them, and nurturing in faith, the two of you together. I remember helping BBS, and then he's going to give me a ride home. So he shows up with the motorcycle. The wooden sailor, still there, I saw it the other day, made a few trips. Coffee. And, poof coffee. That he did like. No way around that. He loved his dogs. He said they was his dogs. And all the times and the events and the birthdays and the anniversaries and the weddings, the graduations. He loved every one of you, and that was important to him. And the friends and the family that's here is an acknowledgement of that. Lives that he touched, shared, gave away that are here today to share that time, share the memories. Talk about Wisconsin a little bit. Snowmobiling and fishing. He was in the Navy and he learned machinist. A lot of years. And he talked about the projects that he did in the machine shop. The spools that he made made them for the water, for the plants, for the dams, the hydro. And it was intricate and it was special, and they asked him to do those because he was capable and excelled at it. He was a cook. Not much. Okay, he did the grill. I laughed. Okay. Not in the house. The grill. He was a bowler. And you talked about mentoring younger bowlers to teach them, to guide them in the proper way, in the proper techniques. He was a builder. Construction around the house, right? Yeah, the kitchen cabinets in the pantry. Some of the things he undertook. Working, do it on his spare time. And then elevating the ceiling, the roof. I've heard sometimes about sleeping under the stars. Because it took a time, it took a while, right? That was an undertaking. And putting new rafters in there and elevating the ceiling so it was proper drain and water, so it would be good. the doors, and the deck. Improving all the time. And you're going to have that with you. I remember on the Cedar Road in the house, the ponds, fish ponds. And you have a pond now at your house, again, because Brandon was always willing to point out the fishes in there. If you couldn't go out fishing in the lake, you had to have some fish in front of you, with you. Woodworking and the tools. I heard about sandboxes and toy boxes that he gave away to make sure that you had. He's around the house. He was involved with church, especially with the food distributions. Him and the driver of the Second Harvest used to compare pickups, see which one had the best one. Who had the most, what had which on engine, and which had the transmission, which had the style and options on it. The fall dinners usually ended up with some cookies. But he was fun and he enjoyed life. And he laughed a lot. And he offered one time for an auction to go to the Roosevelt, take a group, do a fishing tour, teaching technique. And one of the members here bought it for mom and dad. And they were thrilled because Len showed them the proper way to fish and technique and introduced them to it. And they got, now they have a boat and have gone walleye fishing because of that. Kept in contact with Facebook, followed up. So we talk about fishing. When I talk to Len, you talk fishing. He took us out a couple times when we had our boats and showed us where to go and what kind of bait, what kind of technique, what kind of approach, and how to fish properly or rightly on Columbia. There wasn't a bay, there wasn't a mile, there wasn't a stretch of that river he did not know. Fishing. Remember the surgeries and being in the hospital and giving it to the Lord. Every day that he had and the day that he, the Lord, carried him through and gave him that new life, in a sense. And the life that he shared with you and the times and events and the situation, and he shared with friends that were touched and impacted by him and here today to remember that and to remember Len. Family, friends, loved ones. Everyone that knew Len and loved him dearly. And he loved you dearly as family. Sharing with the games and the times. And I remember him sewing. I got that the other day. Sewing for a costume. Big tough Len with a sewing needle in his hand. Right? Thank you for the times that we get to spend and fishing and being around the house and just talking. So we do grieve a little today. We have to. But we celebrate because he is in his eternal rest. He's with the Lord. He has that same grace, that same faith, baptized in the Lord. And we thank him for every gift and blessing that he's granted to Lynn. And carry you through the days ahead with his joy and his peace and his blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. No, Lori. Anything to say?
fishing a little more. My family just wanted to thank you all today for helping us celebrate my dad. As you know, my dad was one of those people that loved and could talk to anybody, anywhere. One time, when his mom passed away, my dad and I drove to Pennsylvania together. And I guess my dad got tired of talking to me because we got out of the car and he took the keys and went into the restroom and 10 minutes went by, 15 minutes went by, and I'm like, geez, what's wrong with Dad? So I said to this man, could you go in and ask Lynn Leslie if he'd come out? So the man came down and came back out. He said, your dad's talking, he'll be right back. So I sat outside the waiting room waiting for my dad while he was in the bathroom talking to a gentleman. One of the things that I loved about my dad taught all of us to talk to anybody, talk to everybody, make friends with everybody, never judge somebody, always be open. And that's one of the things that I love about my dad, because I've been in HR for the last 25 years, and I've hired hundreds of people that were never given a first chance or a second chance. And just because of that way my dad taught me, when I interview people, I don't care what they can do. I care who they are, because those people can work together and you can teach them anything. So I'm blessed that my father taught me that. I used to joke all the time that my dad had a name disease. He had a fishing, bowling, hunting, and he used to make fun of that. But as you can tell by today, I know that I greeted people here today that have worked with my dad, have fished with my dad, played pool with my dad. I can see by all the people in this room that my dad has touched so many lives, and we are so grateful for all of you, and I hope you remember the goofy jokes that my dad used to tell you, because they were pretty corny most of the time, but we still laughed. My dad's last day in the hospital, I stayed the night with him, and we had the best time. He'd fall asleep for a while, and then he'd wake up, and he'd been there for days, and he couldn't have the things that he wanted, because my dad wanted coffee and he wanted sugar and he wanted candy. And so in the middle of the night, I said, Dad, what do you need? I need a glass of milk. So I ran out and got him a cold glass of milk. And he chugged that glass of milk and he said, now that's reality, kid. And he fell back asleep. The pastor came to see us and we chatted a bit and they joked, and pastor prayed for him just before he left. If you know my dad loves to say to you, I'm glad you got to see me. And he says it to everybody. And so the pastor went to leave and my dad looked at him and said, I'm glad you got to see me. Just shortly after that, his last request was to have a cup of coffee because he hadn't had one in days. And so he believed that Samantha was going to go and get him his cup of coffee and bring it back to him. But by that point, my dad wasn't swallowing very well, so they had these little green sponge thingies that you could put liquid in and put in his mouth. And so Jennifer ran out and got him a cup of coffee that he thought was cup of coffee, because she poured like 40 creamers into it. And we stuck it in my dad's mouth, and he loved it so much he didn't even stick it out. And then soon after that, he started to doze off. My family mom says to him, hey, Lynn, all these years you promised to tell me why you loved me. Will you tell me now? And my dad was quiet, and he looked at her, and he goes, no, not now. That's my dad, all the way to the end. I got to catch up on my notes. I'm sorry, I'm not good pastor here. A little while longer went by, and Mom was trying to stay strong, and she was talking to Dad, and she says, Dad, is there anything that we need to know? Lynn, is there anything we need to know? Is there anything you need to tell us? And he said, yeah, you need to remember to tell your dad that words are better than shepherds. Your dad was his best wife. He never did anything that he didn't want to do. That is the reason that he was happy, because he didn't do this wrong. So please take that as a lesson from my dad to live your life and be happy. Don't do things that you don't want to do. In our house, we've taught the kids. We have 2 3-year-old granddaughters, grandsons, and they want to know where their papa is. And so we told Papa, told them that Papa's fishing with Jesus. Well, the other day, little Serenity says to me, "Well, Mima, do you think he's having fun?" And I said, "Honey, I think he's having the time of his life." So on that last note, Dad, please do not fish Jesus, because you never know where you're going to end up.
Sorry, guys. But he said, this time, a good friend schooled me on how to catch fish.
We join together in prayer. We pray to the Lord our God and Father who raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Almighty God, you knit your chosen people together in that common union in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Grant that all who've been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may live that newness of life and pass through that gate of death in the grave to our joyful resurrection. Grant that all have been nourished by the holy body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, is seated with him in that heavenly banquet. Give to all the family of Lynn and to all who mourn today with the grief and the comfort and assurance of your loving care, that casting all our sorrows on you, you may know the consolation of your love. Give courage and faith to everyone. Your church, strengthen to meet the days ahead with the assurance of that holy and certain hope. Thank you, Lord, that you give us that celebration of life and love in you. Your grace and mercy do carry us through each day. Receive our thanks for the life and love you gave to Len and to all the blessings you bestowed on him in his earthly life. Bring us at last to our heavenly home that we may see you face to face and know that we will join him and all the saints in your mercy. O God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks that for his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened up the kingdom of heaven. That believing in him, strengthened with that confidence, because he lives, we shall live also. In that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come can ever separate us from your love, which is ours in Christ Jesus the Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for this day and your joy and your peace. In his name. Our response this now is number 461. I know that my Redeemer lives. You will find it in your hymnal, 461, verses 1, 5, 6, 7, and 8.
Thank you.
and remembering the joys and the laughter and the fun and the challenges that I faced and love that he gave and shared, we go forth in that celebration of life and love in the Lord and our Savior Christ Jesus, and the peace that be with you now and always, in Jesus' name, amen. No.